Good morning, church. Pastor Kathy here with you on our online platform for worship. As many of you already know, we are suspending in-person worship for the next few weeks, and we are going to be coming to you each Sunday morning at 10 a.m. through this platform for worship services. I would ask that you hold our community in prayer. Our reason for suspending in-person worship is because the number of coronavirus cases in our county and surrounding counties have been increasing exponentially, and we just feel like it is the responsible thing for us to do, to not be meeting in person at this time, but to be offering online worship and asking you to consider the ways that you can be more safe and still be able to worship with us here at First United Methodist Church. A couple of things I want to share with you. As I said, we're not going to be having in-person worship services, but we are going to continue to have some of our small groups and outside groups meeting at the church. We are requiring, by a requirement that came from the Missouri Conference Bishop Robert Farr, that everyone must wear a mask the entire time that they're in the church. That folks maintain a 6-foot social distance, and that any group that meets not exceed 25% of the capacity of the room that they are in or the space that they are in. So if folks will continue to follow those requirements, that's pretty much what we've been doing since March. We'll continue to have some of our small groups meet that would like to continue to meet at the church. Other announcements, please continue to check out online worship as we are going through this season of Advent. We have today, Christ the King Sunday, the Sunday before Thanksgiving. Next Sunday will be the first Sunday in Advent. Can you believe it's here already, folks? It's amazing how this year has flown, and then not, right? Anyway, as we begin the season of Advent, our worship team has been working on some different specials to share with you, vocal specials, instrumental specials, just to share the carols of the season and be able to just put us in that spirit of preparing our hearts for the coming of the Christ child one more time during this season of expectation, this season of Advent. So be sure and connect with us online during that time. I think you're going to find your heart filled with hope and love and joy and peace. Things we all really need in 2020. Amen. So those are our announcements for right now. We'll be having more announcements as we have various online worship services posted throughout the next few weeks. And then also be watching for announcements that may be coming through this platform or posted on Facebook or posted on our Instagram account or the church website. So I hope that you enjoy today's worship service, and it's a blessing to have you with us in worship today.
Thank you. Come to worship Jesus Christ, Alpha and Omega, the one who is, who was, and is to come.
We come to worship the one who rules justly.
Come to worship Jesus Christ, the faithful witness, the firstborn of the dead, the ruler of the kings of the earth.
Bread of heaven, God with us.
Good shepherd, true vine.
Eternal word, great I am.
Wonderful counselor, prince of peace.
We come to worship Jesus Christ,
king of kings and lord of lords.
To him be glory and dominion forever and ever. Amen.
Blessings and peace, my sweet friends, to you and all in your kingdom. We gather in this time of prayer realizing that we are not in church, not in the building, and yet we worship God wherever we are. We're able to. And so I sit at my table at home, and oddly, this is a little thing that I have in front of me to remind me of the time that we are living in. I ask you to join me in prayer. I ask you just this moment to think of things that you would like to pray for, a person, a situation. And as I speak, I pray that you will think them. You may even speak them out loud. I have gathered at my table. This is my table. How I wish we were at a table together. And we are not physically, but certainly we are spiritually always at the table of Jesus Christ, spiritually. So I want to share, I spoke of Julian of Norwich in my message, and you will hear that. And that is a time of 14th century spiritualism. And I want to share a prayer with you that comes from the 13th century. And I want you to hear these words because they are listed in our, I love this. This is our United Methodist hymnal. And it is a prayer called Three Things We Pray. As a church, we might pray them together. And so I'd like you to hear the words. Three things we pray. And I will pray this prayer. But before I do, I would like us to remember healthcare workers and service personnel, and you can add names. You can do that right this moment. People that you're thinking of, that you know are in harm's way, are trying to take care of us. Many things are in front of us, and as we come to this Thanksgiving week, some will meet together and some will not. And we lift all those situations up. We know that we trust God in all things, and we trust God to guide us and direct us in the behaviors that would honor our sense of, as United Methodists, doing no harm, doing good, and honoring God. So as I pray these simple words, spoken centuries ago, prayed centuries ago, and have been prayed since the 13th century, that you would add your prayers. We thank God for the many blessings. We praise God in the tough times. I'm thinking of folks who are hospitalized, folks who are recently released from the hospital, and those who have lost loved ones in such a way that it's not even possible for us to grieve together. I lift them all up. Now hear these words from the 13th century. Thanks be to thee, O Lord Jesus Christ, for all the benefits which thou hast given us, for all the pains and insults which thou hast borne for us. O merciful Redeemer, friend, brother, may we know thee more clearly, love thee more dearly, and follow thee more nearly, for thine own sake. Amen. This is Pastor Marcia Vincent at First United Methodist Church, praying God's blessings on you, praying in agreement with your prayers, trusting God with you. Have a blessed Thanksgiving.
Good Sunday morning, friends.
Pastor Marcia from Lebanon First United Methodist Church on this fourth Sunday of our question or sermon series. It says, God, I have questions. And I am glad you are with us today. You might, I'm going to move just a little bit and don't get excited because I'm just going to do this. We are in a cemetery. Kind of felt like it might be an okay thing to be here today. Because the final question that we have is, and I'm going to read it to you because I don't want to mess it up. It says, when we die, do we go to heaven right away? Or are we stuck here until Jesus comes again and empties the graves? That's an interesting question, isn't it? And as being a pastor, it's a real important question. But you know what's really fascinating is I don't always have people ask that question about themselves. Maybe for a lot of reasons, I don't know exactly. But more often, I am asked this question, or the question comes up in reference to when someone we love dies. Where do you think they are? Do they see me? Will they know me in heaven? Those kinds of questions. In my life, I had a person one time say to me that if my grandma is not in heaven, I'm not going there. And I smiled and I said, what would make you think she's not? You see, scripture is a little bit confusing. I always kind of struggle using that word because I think scripture, we read it at the moment to speak to us in the moment. And life changes and our perspective changes about life and death. And certainly, my goodness, what we're living through right now. It's a tough time. Amen. And so I wanted to share a couple of pieces of scripture that have come to mind, and I want to share them with you. In Genesis, Old Testament, right? Okay. By the sweat of your face you shall eat bread until you return to the ground, for out of it you were taken, you are dust, and to dust you shall return. Now, if you've been to a traditional United Methodist service or Methodist service, you know there is a part in the celebration of life in which we will say ashes to ashes, dust to dust, from whence you came, you shall return. And that's Old Testament, and that's okay with me. Because I'm thinking when we're gone, we don't necessarily need this body, right? Okay, that's what we might think. I think about people who were maybe in a fire or at the bottom of the ocean. And there was a time, really, when I thought about, on the last days, the bodies will be resurrected from the grave. That's why we're out here. And that's why I thought this would be a good place to be today, because that kind of unsettled me a little bit. We know the trumpet shall blast, and those who are here, we've heard the expression, asleep in the Lord, will rise and be part of the new heaven and new earth. Okay, that's biblical. That's part of the world we live in. So it gets a little tension. I think scripture is not so much confusing as there is tension in scripture because of when it was written and to whom it was written. And I think we have to weigh those things out. But I want to share with you a piece of scripture that I love to think about, which sounds horrible, because it's from the biblical gospel, Luke. And growing up, I've said I didn't have a lot of Bible study. I didn't have a lot of scripture learning. And when I would think about Jesus on the cross, I didn't want to think about it. I mean, I wanted to think about what was Easter and ham and bunnies and deviled eggs and that sort of thing. I never really wanted to ponder Jesus Christ on the cross for me. But I want you to go with me today, because this is what ended up happening to me. I went to the scripture and I allowed myself to be fully present with what was going on. So I want you to hear this scripture, and then we'll kind of unpack it a little bit.
Luke 23:33-43. When they came to the place that is called the skull, they crucified Jesus there with the criminals, one on his right and one on his left. And then Jesus said, "Father, forgive them, for they know not what they are doing." And they cast lots to divide his clothing. We're talking about the soldiers who had done this horrific crucifixion. And verse 35 continues, "And the people stood by watching, but the leader scoffed at him, saying, 'He saved others. Let him save himself if he is the Messiah of God, his chosen one.' The soldiers mocked him, coming up and offering him sour wine and saying, 'If you are the king of the Jews, save yourself.' And there was also an inscription over him, 'This is the King of the Jews.' And one of the criminals who were hanged there kept deriding him and saying, 'Are you not the Messiah? Save yourself and us.' But the other rebuked him, saying, 'Do you not fear God, since you are under the same sentence of condemnation? And we have indeed been condemned justly, for we are getting what we deserve for our deeds. But this man has done nothing wrong.' And then he said, 'Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom.' And Jesus replied, 'Truly I tell you, today you will be with me in paradise.'" I love that. I love thinking about the thief who knew he deserved what was happening to him. But in that moment, his life changed. You know, it's kind of like, wow, this is like a last minute save. I've also had people say to me, you know, people have been stinkers all their lives. Do you really think they get to go to heaven? Well, here's what I know. Only God makes that decision who goes to heaven, how that all works out. Only God is going to work out what happens in this place. Only God. And what a God who loves us so much that he gave himself, that he sent. Can you imagine God watching little Jesus grow up, being a baby? Have you ever held a baby and just what it does to you? And then to grow and be in the struggles of life and then commit himself to be our sacrifice. What a God who makes all that happen. Don't you think he's got it figured out what happens to us when we die? I have a colleague, a sweet friend of years ago, and he taught me this expression of closing your eyes in this world and opening in the next, at that moment when we leave this earth. And I realize, you know, that's a comfort piece. I realize it. But don't you think a God that gives us this much hope would be that much comfort? I kind of think it makes sense to me. We are Wesleyans who look at scripture with tradition, reason, and experience. And I've lived a long time. And I have seen things that I cannot believe any other way. That a God who does all that. Right now, I'm listening to birds sing. The sun is so pretty. It may be when you see this, it may be pouring down rain or snow. But for this moment, this is just such a beautiful place. I find such comfort here, which is kind of weird. I know that. But I wanted to share the message. What happens to us when we die? Scripture has tension. But God does not. God has answers to our questions. And I've loved listening to Pastor Kathy and the time we've spent together these last weeks, because it makes me know that God is a big God who can take our questions. When our hearts are broken, when we scream out a question in tears, God listens. I want to encourage you to learn to listen back. This Sunday is Christ the King Sunday. And it's a Sunday before Thanksgiving. I hope you'll find something to be thankful for. I hope you really will, because I believe for all of us, somehow, someway, somehow, there is something to be thankful for. I'm thankful for the person holding my phone right now recording this. I'm thankful for so many things in my life. Is it perfect? No. Good Lord, look at the size of me. Of course it's not perfect. I'm going to eat too much turkey. I'm just telling you straight up. And yet, I'm praising God, and I hope and pray that you will be able to. This is Christ the King Sunday. I will get back to it because this is so cool that I get to preach on Christ the King Sunday, and here's why. Because I didn't always know about Christ the King Sunday. And I just assumed it was like this gazillion-year-old observance. But you know what? It's not. And where it came from is so perfect and precious. I want to read to you because I don't want to mess it up. Traditionally, Christ the King Sunday is the very last Sunday in our church liturgical calendar. And then next Sunday, we begin the first Sunday of Advent, which will be the first week of the new calendar of the Christian year, as we celebrate it, okay? And this really is a relatively recent addition to our calendar. Christ the King Sunday was instituted in 1925 by Pope Pius XI in response to the tragedy of World War I. There was so much catastrophic loss. The world was becoming so jaded and cynical. And so church leaders, he was part of it. Other church leaders came up upon it and said, wow, yes. And it was a time for us to face the chaos and know that the world is divided. And certainly today, boy, was this a good thing for us to hear today. That sometimes it does seem like it's ruled by dark forces. But Christ the King is meant to remind us that in the end, God does reign over all things. There's a Julian of Norwich, and if you don't know that, it's Julian of Norwich. I challenge you to Google that this afternoon or sometime in the next week. Really interesting story how this woman, who is pretty fabulous, I think, and she was a writer, and what is so weird about it is she was like in the 14th century, and her writings live on. So I'm going to give you that little tidbit. Google her. Start looking for things. And she is the author of these words, all is well and all shall be well, which means that it's well and good today, and in God's future for us, it always will be well. Isn't that great? Christ the King Sunday says our task is not only to trust in his truth, but to live into the kind of lives through which the Holy Spirit of God can work to bring the full reign of Christ into fruition in all creation. Isn't that beautiful? Christ the King Sunday is the most perfect time to think about and ponder in the midst of this chaos. What happens when we die? I also have had another wonderful experience in which a person said to me, if you die tonight, where will you go? What will happen, essentially? That's the statement, right? And I read and read this book, because he wrote a book. How great is that? Waddell, W-A-D-D-E-L-L. And the question is, if I die tonight, what's going to happen? It's not really my necessary question, being a Christian. If I get to live another 20 years, what am I going to do for God? That's kind of a cruel question, don't you think? I think we can question. I think we can get together and have conversations, and I look forward to that. I'm missing you all. I'm going to tell you straight up till we get this thing squared away. But know that you are loved and you are prayed for. And I know God's got a plan in all this. We don't have to understand it. We're not going to understand it. But know that a God who plans all these things is a trustworthy God that loves us more than we can imagine. And I pray that you'll feel that. And I want you to pray with me. Would you pray with me? Holy and loving God, we breathe in you. We have questions, and you have answers. Fill us with peace. Fill us with everything we need, that people might look at us and realize we are yours. In the midst of this pandemic, in the midst of this chaos, and just flat out meanness, flat out selfish arrogance, God, we want to be your ambassadors. We want to be the spirit that might answer somebody's question, that they might have about God. That's what we want, God. We want to be able to be your people who bring some little peace to wherever we are. It's in the name of Jesus we pray, by the power of the Holy Spirit. We say amen. Thank you, friends. God bless you. Happy Turkey Day coming up. And be good to each other and stay safe. Love you.
Now's the time in our worship service where we have our offering. It's that time during the service that we return a portion of our blessings, a portion of our gifts, back to God through First United Methodist Church. If you'd like to use the online giving button, it's right there on the homepage of the church website. Or if you'd like to mail a check in, you can do so to P.O. Box 470 here in Lebanon. Let us pray and offer the best of ourselves back to God. Pray with me, please. Father God, we ask that you bless these gifts, these offerings that we return to you back through this church. We ask, God, that you be with the leaders of our church and guide and direct them to use these resources to further the work of your kingdom in this community and in all of the world. And as always, oh God, we give you thanks for the many ways that you bless us, those that we recognize, those that we just don't see. We know your presence, oh God, is with us always. And this offering, this returning of these financial gifts, this is just one way that we give ourselves back to you, because of the ways that you so freely and gracefully give to us. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, all God's people say, amen.